good morning and welcome everybody to a Sunday morning time together of worship and praise. And to if you were watching on YouTube, we pray that you'll be blessed as you watch this during the week. I always think sometimes when you've been, well, either doing Zooms, it seems that we've been doing Zoom meetings for the last, well, I don't know how long now, it seems a long time, part of our life, or whether you've been going, once it's gathering together as church family for a long time, it's easy just to turn up on a Sunday. And this morning, what I'd like us to do, I'd just ask the question, how thirsty are you? How thirsty for God are you? As you know, I've been, since last January, been in one sense transfixed by that very simple little phrase, be careful how you listen. Be very careful how you listen. And I went back to that in Luke chapter 8, and I read on a little bit, and it's quite challenging. It says, be careful how you listen, because that which you have, I'll add, or that which you haven't got, I'll take away. We're in a wonderful time where God is wanting to give to each one of us so much more. And somehow it's linked to our hearts and our ears listening. And if you didn't know, you can listen but not hear. And you can look and you can't see. This morning, let's listen. Let's look. Let's seek. Because one thing we do know is that God is here. Father is with us. And he gives this wonderful promise. Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you who don't have money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine, milk, without money and without cost. And he asks us the question, why do you spend money for what is not bread, and your wages for what does not satisfy? And here it is again. Listen carefully to me and eat what is good and delight yourself in abundance. And again, incline your ear and come to me. Listen that you might have life. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you. Wonderful, isn't it? So, as is our wont, just a few seconds on your own, in your own room. Compose yourself. Come as you're coming to royalty, to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We reverence. We're a fairly informal type of church. But sometimes we need to remember that we're coming into the throne room, to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And you don't make a noise when you come up to the throne. You bow. You listen. You adore. So just in your own room, just prepare yourself. Father, we're gathered together to worship you, to praise you, and to give you your worth. And we ask you, Lord, that you speak to us, you pour out your spirit upon us as we sing these simple songs, but they are worship to you. They are words of adoration. And Lord, as we sing this first song, in the beginning was the Word. We remember your Son, Jesus, our Saviour. So speak to us this morning, Lord, move amongst us by the power of your Spirit. And everybody said, Amen. Amen.
Savior has done. overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh hero, oh hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive, break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken to life. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. We declare he's been faithful. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. Oh hero, oh hero, conquered the grave. You're free, recaptive, break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken to life. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name's lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Sing it together, hallelujah. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things, yeah. Oh hero, oh hero, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken to life. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. You have done great. Gonna sing hallelujah. And hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things.
Came down, I can sing of your love for
Presence of God through those songs of worship. A time now to say our prayers, say our songs. Get intimate with God. It's about intimacy this morning.
I'd just say something, Mike.
Yeah, please.
Just got quite excited by them first two songs. When I first used to come to church, I used to get really anxious when we were singing. I used to always feel like everybody's watching me. And now I feel this joy in my heart. I can't wait to get back into the church hall and stand with you all and belt them songs out as loud as I can now. It's funny because thinking about that used to cause me anxiety. Now it causes me joy, to be honest. So yeah, I just felt
Stu, God. Yeah, Stu, just pray to God now. Just let it. You just lead us in prayer, and then we'll follow our lost Jews. Just enjoy saying what you want, Stu.
Yeah. Just pray for when we're all back in the hall, and I know everybody else is starting to feel the normality of life coming back. I saw the excitement of the church yesterday, Lord, of everybody being gathered together in small groups, and the excitement of the church being back together. And I know everybody can't wait, and it's such a joy to see that moment coming to us. And so yeah, just pray for some patience, because the excitement is overwhelming sometimes for everybody. And I just pray and hope for us all to be back together in the love of God. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord, that you are a God of transformation. Thank you that you love to bring change. Thank you, Lord, that you change things in our lives. You turn our lives around. And we bless you for the changes you've brought about in Stu and in Adam and in many others in our experience. And we give you all the praise and the glory.
I'm reading from Psalm 111. All God accomplishes is flawless, faithful, and fair. And his every word proves trustworthy and true. They are steadfast forever, formed from truth and righteousness. His forever love paid a full ransom for his people. So now we are free to come before Jehovah to worship his holy and awesome name. Father, we thank you that we can indeed come into the royal throne room because we are your precious children. We are now part of that royal family. We are clothed in royal robes of righteousness because, Jesus, you paid the full ransom for us, for me, for each one of us here this morning and beyond. You paid the price for each one of us. Amen. And so we just thank you and praise you this morning. We've come to worship your holy and awesome name this morning because, Jesus, you paid the price for us. We are free. We are holy. We are righteous. We are royal priesthood this morning. We can stand in the Holy of Holies with you because of what you did, Jesus. Thank you. Praise your name, Lord.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord, that we can express our love to you and to one another, but only because you loved each one of us first. Thank you for your great love. Thank you for laying down your life so that we could be free. And just as we were worshiping God through that second song, Great Things, you know, that's a great thing that God's done. We must never forget how great that is. But I just felt God say, it's simple. He just said, I sensed he said, I've put you together. And he was saying two things. I've put you together, this sort of family in front of me. I've put you people together for my purposes. And I just felt God was saying as well, I love putting people together and I love putting individual lives back together again. And I just thank God for that, that he wants to put us, our lives back together again. And he's working in each one of us. So thank you, Lord. We want to be a thankful people this morning. Thank you that we can express that never-ending love to you. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Just want to encourage you, don't wait for somebody else to give praise to God. Speak out, let our hearts be open to that. Allow the Spirit to come to worship before the throne. As Mal was saying, he accepts us, he loves us. Thank you.
Lord, I thank you so much that you keep your promises. That the words you speak over us are words of truth. That you give us back the years that the locusts have stolen. That you lift us on wings of eagles.
Thank you.
You give us robes of righteousness, that you call us your brother, your sister. That we are welcome in the throne room. Lord, thank you for everything that you have done in my life.
Thank you.
For being that faithful person that is there through everything. Lord, I thank you for today.
Thank you.
Lord, I want to thank you for being in my life. You have walked with me all the way. When I have stumbled, you have held me up. When I've strayed, you've led me back. And I just want to give thanks today, Lord, for that walk with you. For throughout all the difficulties and all the joys and everything that life has brought, you have been there, the constant one. Mm. You have loved me even when I have forgotten to love you. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Just before we break bread together, and we're going to break out into little groups, probably five or so, Richard or Rona, in a minute. Could we just together, if you would like to, just corporately get that picture that would be for, you know, as Val painted, before the throne and before the God who is sovereign and king and glorious, but somehow he's also our Father. Let's just corporately maybe open up our hands and just say, we're worshiping you. We worship you, Lord. Your family, people here, Lord, in Market Raised and through this area, worship you. We lift our hands just as a simple sign to you as best we can that we're opening up our lives to you. That we want to know more of you. We want to have our eyes opened and our ears opened. What are you doing, Lord? What are you saying to us? Help us to move in your ways. Fill us afresh with your Holy Spirit. Lord, we know you, but we want to know more together. So as we're lifting our hands up to you, Lord, now pour out your Spirit upon us corporately in these days. Thank you for those amazing words that you call us priests, you call us kings, little owed us, and yet you've invested in your church so much. Bless everyone who's lifting their hands and watching today, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Right, guys, we're going to break down into little groups. Now, just wanted to just say before, we're going to break bread and drink wine together. I just want to say a little bit, look, you don't need to be a vicar or have priestly garments to take a lead in breaking bread and drinking wine, all right? So let's just make that sort of clear, right? You don't have to say special words. We're simply coming with this very, very simple two symbols of bread and wine in your little groups, and we're going to share it together. A symbol of Jesus' body broken for us. He died that our sins might be forgiven, and some wine or juice that symbolizes the new covenant that Jesus inaugurated. So please don't feel reticent. Just say the words that you want to do to remember Jesus Christ together. If you want to pray with one another, if there's something, please do that. It's only going to be back for about 5 or 7 minutes, but just enjoy the time being together and being church. So thank you, Rona.
Isn't it lovely to see people coming back? Something very exciting and thrilling about seeing those pictures reappear on the screen.
Yeah, absolutely. Right, folks, we are going to continue with our look at John. The story unfolds as we look at Jesus. And we now come to a very familiar passage. So it's a challenge for Andy to preach on this, the feeding of the 5,000. If you want to follow it, it's John 6, verses 1 to 14. So over to Andy.
In conversation with a chap a while back, the subject of belief, and in particular, belief in the miracles of Jesus as recorded in Scripture, came up, proving a stumbling block to this fella. He could not, under any circumstances, accept them, or any other miracles for that matter. Like so many, he claimed science had proved they just could not have happened, and at best were merely stories to illustrate a point. But as far as this bloke was concerned, no more than fairy tales. He argued with some veracity that I was asking him to suspend belief. He cited the miracle that we'll be looking at this morning as case in point, the ridiculousness of it. So, to kick off this morning, let's examine this further. Remember why John wrote his gospel as we head in. What's his entire raison d'etre here? Let's go chapter 20, verse 31 again, to remind ourselves. But these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Throughout the Gospel, John is signposting and bringing evidence that Jesus is who he says he is, and leaving us with two choices: believe and be saved, reject and face the ultimate judgment. Now, Jesus' miracles are integral to this evidence, not the whole hog, but a huge part. And John is not asking us to suspend belief at all, more to expand it beyond what can be understood, beyond the merely natural and physical, into supernatural and metaphysical. Now, a lot of folk get awfully bogged down here, and I think miss out big time, tending to disappear down a rabbit hole of concentrating too much on one side or the other. Yet again, John preempts this by stating very clearly that Jesus is both fully God and fully man, fully natural, fully physical, fully supernatural, and fully metaphysical. Incidentally, in case you're wondering what I'm rattling on about with the word metaphysical, it's derived from the Greek meta-da-physica, which means after or beyond things of nature. It refers to an idea or doctrine or reality outside of human sense perception. As such, it's concerned with explaining the features of reality that exist beyond the physical world and our immediate sense. Miracles seem, and I'm aware this is worthy of much deeper study, to fit into this category, a reality that exists beyond our understanding and the physical world we inhabit. Deep stuff, eh? Right then, back to my mate and his issues with miracles. For a short period this morning, we're going to look at some of the evidence. Always a good solid place to get stuck in. Remember last week, Rona brought to us testimonies of Jesus and who he says he is. He brought presenting us with witnesses, the witness of the Father, the witness of John the Baptist, of Scripture, finally, of miracles. Quick look at miracles then. First, the number of miracles Jesus performed was sufficient, or enough, for honest inquirers to believe in them. The four Gospels record Jesus performing about 35 separate miracles, or 38 depending on how you count them. Most of the miracles that Jesus performed are recorded in more than one Gospel. Two of his miracles, the feeding of the 5,000, which we look at later, and the resurrection, are found in all four Gospels. In addition, each Gospel writer says that Jesus performed many, many more miracles than they recorded. Why would you not record them? Simply because there were too many to write down? I don't know. The vast number of miracles in which Jesus performed demonstrates that they were a regular part of his ministry. The miracles of Jesus were also of sufficient variety to show that he had miraculous power. Of the specific miracles recorded in the four Gospels, we find that 17 were bodily cures, 6 were healing of demonic possession, 9 were miracles of nature, and then there were 3 occasions when he raised someone from the dead. Of the 17 specific healing miracles, there's a variety of different illnesses that Jesus healed, including leprosy, paralysis, fever, shriveled limbs, an amputated ear, blindness, deafness, muteness or dumb, and blood hemorrhaging. Jesus also had authority over life and death. The Bible records 3 specific cases of Jesus resurrecting someone from the dead: Jairus' daughter, who just died, the widow of Nain's son, who was just in the coffin, and Lazarus, who'd been dead and in the tomb for 4 days. Jesus showed his control over the three stages of death. Those who just died, those who were going to be buried, and those already in the tomb. As the Son of God, he exercised his authority over all realms. The Gospel of Matthew in 8th and 9th chapters relates many different areas over which Jesus demonstrated his authority. The point of recording these various miracles is to show that Jesus is the Lord of every realm imaginable. Healing incurable diseases, healing from a distance. He had the ability to heal someone without even being there. As a centurion approached Jesus on behalf of his paralyzed servants, the centurion's faith was such that he believed his servant would be healed if Jesus just gave the word. There was no need for his actual presence. He exhibited power to heal when he was not present, nor even near the afflicted person. This demonstrates that he's the Lord of space and time. Not only Lord over disease, he's also Lord over nature. A great storm arose on the Sea of Galilee, covering a boat with waves, and he calmed the storm, displaying authority over nature, the realm of the visible world. Jesus also had authority over the supernatural realm. Jesus met two demon-possessed men who were terrorizing the countryside. When Jesus approached, they cried out, "What have we to do with you, Jesus, you Son of God? Have you come here to torment us before my time?" He cast out demons into a herd of pigs, and the two men returned to normal. By doing this, Jesus showed authority in the area of the supernatural, or the metaphysical, the invisible reign. In one short boat trip on the Sea of Galilee, Jesus showed his authority over both the visible and invisible. He had authority over the forgiveness of sins. The account in Matthew 9:1-8, where healing of a paralyzed man, Jesus showed that his authority extended to the forgiveness of sins. He had authority over life and death. Even death is subject to Jesus' authority. Absolutely amazing, isn't it? That Jesus had authority over incurable disease, being able to heal without being physically present. He has authority over nature, over the supernatural. He has authority over sins, over life and death, and over the natural and supernatural at the same time. None of this ever happened in secret. Another important fact concerning Jesus' miracles is that they were done publicly, and the facts concerning the miracles of Christ were well known. If not, why would Paul make such a bold statement in Acts when he says, "I am not mad, most noble Festus, but speak the words of truth and reason, for the king before whom I also speak freely knows these things. For I am convinced that none of these things escapes his attention, since this thing was not done in a corner. It's all out in the open." When Jesus rose on Easter Sunday, he walked, unrecognized, with his two disciples on the road to Emmaus. When Jesus asked them, "What are you talking about?" he received the swallowing response. And one of them, named Cleopas, answered and said to him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem and unaware of the things which have happened in these days?" Everybody knew that Jesus performed miracles. Adding to that, the land of Israel was a strategic place in the Roman Empire, in the middle of a great crossroads. A large amount of travel occurred through the Holy Land. This is the spot where Jesus performed his miraculous deeds, not on some barren fringe of the empire where no one would observe them. He performed his miracles where the maximum number of people could see for themselves that they were genuine. They were performed before large crowds, as we will see later on. And they never occurred in one special place. He had the ability to perform miracles with him wherever he went. whether it was by the Sea of Galilee, in Jerusalem, Jericho, the miracle power went with him. There was no staging area where Jesus brought those who needed healing. There's no way in which his followers could control any event or outcome. Added to no special place, there was no special time of day, morning, noon and night, and all seasons of the year. They weren't just restricted to Jews, they were performed before Gentiles. They were done without any props, and they were done with restraint. Whenever Jesus performed a miracle, it was always done for a specific purpose, for two basic reasons. As a sign, as we know, to testify of God's existence and power, and to meet specific need. They were never performed as a sideshow or to attract attention. For instance, when he was being tempted by the devil, he refused to use his miraculous powers to show off. The devil wanted him to throw himself down from the pinnacle of the temple and let the angels miraculously save him. But Jesus just didn't stoop to that sort of supernatural sideshow. He'd done beneficial miracles, and they were not done for his own advantage. They met real needs, and they were done with great ease. Performed without ceremony or ostentatious behaviour, with great ease and care and compassion. And they were recorded by eyewitnesses. Reaction to Jesus' miracles is, well, exactly what you'd expect. Those who witnessed them were not gullible. Must be recognised that people living at that time of Jesus were as sceptical as you and me. And one need only look at the responses by the people to see that that was the case. They'd never seen this sort of thing before. Jesus' miracles were never denied. No one could deny them. Religious rulers who were enemies of Jesus sought to discredit him, yes, but they didn't deny them. They attributed them to the power of the devil. Everyone was aware of his miracles, as we've said earlier. They were an essential part of Jesus' ministry. Not an afterthought, not a sideshow, but an essential part. Just going to do a quick summary then. We can say the following about these miracles. There was a sufficient number of them. They were of a vast variety. They covered all areas of authority, and they were done publicly in strategic locations, before large crowds, and there was no special place where they occurred or special time. They were performed in front of Gentiles as well as Jews, without props and with restraint. Miracles that were beneficial, not for Jesus' own advantage, as they met real needs. And they're in contrast to other miracles performed, or alleged miracles performed, I should say, by others. They were done with ease. They were recorded by eyewitnesses, and those who witnessed them had exactly the same reaction that we would have. They were never denied, and there was sufficient testimony to them. I think we can conclude then that Jesus' miracles were an essential part of his ministry and were true and really happened. Now, to the matter in hand. The feeding of the 5,000, well, actually many more, as John only records the men, chucking the women and children, and you're probably looking at a crowd of 10,000 or more. That's a lot of people. As I mentioned earlier, all four of the gospel writers bring their own perspective to the story, each one emphasising different aspects, but with the same overall narrative. It's worth studying the whole lot and comparing to get the full picture. It appears in Matthew chapter 14, Mark in chapter 6, and chapter 9 of Luke. Also, I'd recommend reading round each one to provide insight into what precedes and what follows each account. And, of course, John in chapter 6, which is where we turn to now. Get me big Bible out. Are you listening? So John chapter 6, and I'm starting at verse 1 and going through to, I think it's verse 15. Sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, and a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he'd been performing by healing those who were ill. Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover festival was near. I've just got to move my Bible a bit so I can see better. There we go. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming towards him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite." Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here's a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish, but how far will that go amongst so many?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they'd all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted." So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who'd eaten. After the people saw the signs performed, they began to say, "Surely this is the prophet who is coming to the world." Now Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. Well, what had drawn this huge crowd? Verse 2 tells us why. Because they saw the signs he'd performed by healing those who were ill. Jesus certainly knew how to pull a crowd. Word of him must have spread like wildfire. People had dropped what they were doing and headed after, told their mates, brought the family along. Well, as with any large crowd, I would expect hawkers and tradesmen and sellers to tag along too, promoting their wares, snacks, drinks, etc. Maybe some of the family parties had even packed a picnic. But by the time we get to the edge of this mountainside, where Jesus sat down with the disciples, any such earlier provision had long gone. The traders sold out, the picnics eaten, the snacks scoffed. Many, no doubt, had been so enthralled by Jesus that they'd made no prior arrangements at all. Swept along by the excitement of the crowd, overawed by what they were seeing, captivated in the moment. Things, though, were changing. It was getting late. We're out in the middle of nowhere. Evening's coming. It'll be dark soon. The people are hungry and beginning to get restless. As usual, Jesus knew exactly what he was doing, and he threw poor old Philip a bit of a curveball. Verses 5 and 6. To test him? Odd turn of phrase to use there. Jesus is asking Philip, and by extension the rest of the disciples, how they propose to solve the problem of this extremely large and hungry crowd, in order to both test them and therefore grow their faith. Unlike the devil, who will use tests and challenges to entangle and trap in sin, Jesus tests us to grow us, to strengthen us. What Jesus wants to see and hear is where they're going to turn in times of hardship. To him or to ourselves? Well, the disciples offer 3 possible solutions. First one, and this is so common, ignore the problem by sending the people away. That sort of get rid of it, but hardly satisfactory, just moves it somewhere else. Or onto someone else. Mark 6:36 tells us that some of the disciples said, "Send them into the local towns and villages. Go on, tell them to go." Another one, and this is all too common, throw money at it, as Philip somewhat sarcastically puts it in verse 7. Or in 3, in the case, in the case of Andrew, making an attempt to work and solve it, however inadequately as it appears at face value in verse 8, and a bit of a token gesture. Seem to be doing something, but without any real belief it'll actually do any good or work. Well, in all the above, we can clearly see the hopelessness of the situation from any sort of resolution in human terms. Thousands of hungry people and a complete lack of resources to deal with it. But Jesus does not totally dismiss or contradict any of these, but comes at it from a fundamentally different angle. Each of the disciples start by focusing on human efforts, whereas Jesus resolution is to begin with a humble appeal to Father God, verse 11. He does not dismiss even this paltry offering as anything other than more than sufficient. No, instead, he gives thanks for it. Amazing. Now, I'm fascinated by the boy with the bread and the fish. All we know from the text is that a boy comes forward with five small barley rolls and a couple of dried fish. Cheap packed lunch probably given him by his mum. Now, barley bread was traditionally eaten by the poorer people, being of a lower quality and cheaper than wheat, and the loaves themselves were probably no bigger than these sort of little finger rolls. But let's face it, dried fish too is a bit at the budget end of. It's not an M&S fancy sandwich. Yet this lad showed immense faith, I think, in bringing them forward to Jesus. Immense faith in being prepared to give to Jesus what little he had. He could have kept his head down, looked after himself and eaten it all, and yes, it would have filled him up, but done nothing for anything else. His faith extended into the unknown. It's not like he knew what was about to happen, is it? Yet he came forward and handed it all to Jesus. It's an easy thing to hold on to what we have, or to treat what we do have as not adding up to much. Jesus says, bring it to me. Let me work with it. Mike, in his Easter message, mentioned the word vocation in terms of being part of something that's bigger than yourself. I think this term is encapsulated brilliantly in the attitude of this boy. He'd been hearing Jesus talk, seeing the healings and miracles, and this drew him in. He'd brought what he had to Jesus, and this made both him and his offering so much more than himself. When we give both of ourselves in terms of resources and ourselves in entirety to Jesus, we become part of something bigger than ourselves. It appeared in the greater scheme of things that this boy's offering was futile. As Andrew says in verse 9, how far will this go amongst so many? What possible difference can my little bit make? What if even the little bit you have got you think is worthless, dirty, of no value? Well, this is where Jesus says, bring that to me too. The dirty secrets we all have hidden, the stuff in our lives that causes pain, anger, hurt, guilt. It's okay, says Jesus. I'll take it all upon myself. Here at the cross, that's the deal. You bring your worst and throw it all at me. Now, that really is a miracle. And you know what he'll do first? Verse 11. He will give thanks to his Father God. In the words of an old song, he took all my guilt and shame when he died and rose again. Now, I've been spending some time recently with a chap who's been very hurt by life. He's in real pain. Life has thrown everything at him. And he's pretty much at rock bottom. What's not helped is what I call, and we do see it a bit too often, well-meaning people often Christians, offering in platitudes without any tangible action underpinning it. Andrew the disciple struck me in his actions here. He brought the boy with the fishes and the bread to Jesus, despite his own doubts and lack of belief as well. And there's a big lesson here for us, is that you don't have to have it all nailed down and understood in your own mind and heart to bring others to Jesus. It's okay to be imperfect. It's okay to have many a conflict, many a doubt, as the hymn goes. It's okay to be weak and frail, and it's okay to have doubts. When we offer all that we are to him, when we introduce others to him in obedience, even when we have doubts ourselves, Jesus accepts it. Accepts it all. Right, back to the miracle. We're nearly there. What stands out next for me, and I'll share it with you now, is the oh-so-very public nature of it all. In many respects, it's easier to believe in miracles done discreetly, or where we don't see, you know, rubbing a bit of mud on a bloke's eyes to restore his sight, healing a paralytic man or a woman of bleeding. Yet this miracle is witnessed by so many people, and that many others are also involved in it too. Firstly, Jesus prepared the stage by getting everyone to sit down in groups. No free-for-all scramble here, where the strongest and most pushy get in first. Remember, there were loads of women and children knocking about. This speaks to me of God's provision being for all. The strong, the weak, the young, the old. Men, women, children, everybody, all. Next, after giving thanks, as mentioned in Matthew 14:19, he handed the broken bread to the disciples to distribute. Maybe even to individuals then in the groups to break and share with those around him too. Now, how exciting is that? To be part of a miracle as it happens right before your very eyes. What did it look like to hold one small piece of bread? And as you break it, does it keep coming? Does it become two? Is it like a splitting of cells? Did it suddenly sort of miraculously appear of enough for everybody? But I think very much what Jesus is saying is, it is as he gave it away, more appeared. The more Jesus gives of himself, the more we give of ourselves, the more appears, you see? And it kept on going until everyone had had their fill, and there was leftovers for laters. Jesus exclaimed, "Let nothing be wasted." There are so many metaphors going on here, and please take this week to investigate them and see what they tell us today and how you can put them into practice. Well, it certainly left a big impression on everyone who'd heard, that's for sure. Verse 14 tells us that the crowd exclaimed, "Surely this is the prophet who has come into the world." Yet then we get to 15 and the warning. You see, Jesus saw right through the hearts of the crowd. They wanted Jesus, yes, but on their own terms. In this crowd, same as today, there are many, many different agendas, many different viewpoints. Jesus knew that today they want him because he dealt with a material need on that particular day. Tomorrow, they will be hungry again. Then what? He knows just how fickle we can be. He knows that so many will follow on their own terms when all is going well, when we're well fed and looked after, but how quickly we can fall away when the food stops coming, when the road is tough and the difficulties come at us. Later on in this chapter, as we shall learn in the coming weeks, he addresses the real issue. It's not our stomachs, or not our bank balance, or our health, or our wealth, or career, or anything else that can truly satisfy with any longevity. And while God knows what we need in that area too and will provide, it's our hearts that need bread from heaven. eternal, everlasting bread that comes from one source and one source only.
And as we think about that, let's think about that as we sing and worship in our next two songs.
Grace as our burdens grow greater, he spends us more strength as our labors increase. To added affliction, he offers more mercy. To multiply trials, he multiplies peace. When we have exhausted our store of endurance, when our strength has failed, when we've reached the end of our earthly resources, our Father's full giving is only begun. Our Father's full giving is only begun. So lean hard, lean on the everlasting arms.
Lean on the everlasting. presence in a time of crisis and panic. May you know peace. May you literally know God holding you up. He's got you. Bless you.
Praise God. Right, as we come to close of our meeting, I want to pray over you. I want to do what Jesus would give thanks for each one of you. And I invite you to bring your 5 loaves and 2 fishes to Jesus. Right, you're bringing it, whatever, what you've got. Lord, I give thanks for everything that's being brought to you this morning. Lives, hopes, dreams, fears, uncertainties, difficulties, sickness, sorrow. And in a way, Lord, we give thanks over these things. That just as the 5,000 were fed, you would break out miracles on our lives this morning. Break out miracles upon us, Lord, in everyone's life, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Right, if you'd like to unmute yourself, we are going to bless each other. And then we're going over to the notices. So if you want to unmute, just before we do, as I started off by saying, we're listening. It's just an opportunity, if anybody wants to say something that they've heard or just God was speaking to them, speak now or forever hold your peace.
Can I just read a short piece of scripture that just links what Andy was saying in verses 5 and 6 just reminds me of James 2:4, which is, my fellow believers, when it seems as though you are facing nothing but difficulties, see it as an invaluable opportunity to experience the greatest joy that you can. For you know that when your faith is tested, it stirs up power within you to endure all things. And then as your endurance grows even stronger, it will, until there is nothing missing and nothing lacking.
Amen. Preacher, brother.
Amen.
Amen.
Very good.
I just wanted to say how powerful the last song was.
Yes.
It's just beautiful. It just brings everything up into your heart and, you know, it overflows.
Right. Jane, just put your hand on Ken's going to pray for Ken. Lord, we pray blessing upon Ken. Thank you for his life. Lord, we thank you for Ken and through our thanks, work a miracle. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Anybody else? Right, let's say the grace together. Grace.
Well, Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Thank you, Rhoda.
Thank you, Richard. You're always doing a wonderful job there in the background each week. So, yes, you get used to the notices. And tomorrow night, we never want to be over familiar, though, with the power of prayer. We want to meet together and we want to pray. If you've never been before, I don't want to force you, but come. God will do amazing things, I believe, when we talk to him together. And that's what prayer is. And also tomorrow, Alpha's continuing. We really want to pray for that tomorrow and in the days ahead, as the wonderful participants of that have a double session tomorrow night, when they look together at really who the Holy Spirit is and how the Holy Spirit works in our lives. And without him, we would be at a complete loss. So Jesus has sent his Holy Spirit, but we pray for you now, and we pray for ourselves tomorrow, that you will lead us, Lord, by your Spirit, as we pray for others and for our community too. And then Together for Purpose, we had an important meeting, I believe, last Thursday. If you were not able to be there, and if I haven't already sent summary notes to you, or even if you were there and you'd like to read the summary notes, it's good to consider and pray into these things. I can forward those on to you by email. As you know, we're listening carefully, as Mike says, and we want to be hearing what God's saying as we move forward. And we want to know how to be church together, now and in the days ahead. We know God's doing a new thing amongst us, and together we'll hear his voice, I believe. But if you want those notes, please just ask. And then a massive thank you to everyone who helped yesterday spring clean the church centre. I think there were 20 of us in total in batches of six throughout the day. So thank you to every single one of you. And most of all, we thank God because he's provided us with a building for his plans and purposes. I think there's another picture, Rich, of us being able to enjoy some fellowship together. And it was wonderful to be able to be on that grass. I love it that in the feeding of the 5,000, it says there was plenty of grass in that place and where they sat down. But thank you to everyone. And it was good to hear Stuart say that, you know, he's longing for us to be able to be together, to worship together in person. And I think Mike and I will start looking at that in more detail this week, and just try and let you know what we're sensing is the right time to be doing that together. Obviously, we still have to look at the government guidelines, but there is something powerful about when we meet together. But we're grateful too for Zoom. And thank you, everyone. And next slide, please, Richard. Thank you, everyone, who faithfully has been giving into God's work. I think there's a slide coming up. Yes, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for sending regular donations by your bank, or some of you send envelopes in. We want to use every single penny that God gives us for his plans and purposes to be fulfilled. And if anybody wants to know more about how to give, God loves it when we give cheerfully. And it doesn't matter if we give a little or a lot, if it's given from our heart, that's what God looks at. And I think there's a couple more. Yes, thank you for all the ongoing support. We're about to, as you know, the food bank's been expanding through the year. There's 14 of us, but there are going to be some volunteers over the next months that are not so available. So if you're interested in helping in any way, packing parcels usually takes about a couple of hours, but there's other help that we need in delivering parcels sometimes, and also with some shopping, especially as Pam and Dave will soon be moving to Lincoln. But thank you for all the help, and I know some of you are going to help me on Tuesday morning as we collect all the food supplies from the festival hall, from the committee room there. They are just providing about six or seven parcels at the moment. So everything is going to transfer to us. And in fact, that the festival hall, I think, becomes a drop-in testing centre for COVID. So they need to free up that room there. And it's been good to work in partnership with them through the year. And finally, next week, we will be here again, and Paul will be preaching to us. And I think we'll be walking on water next week, if I remember rightly. So looking forward to that. So thank you very much, Richard. Thank you. Back to Mike.
Privilege is normal just to be with you all and to share. Great time, great preaching. Have a great week. Keep in contact and keep listening. And as well as keeping listening, if you read my notes, and I'll be saying it in the letter, we need to share what we're hearing, right? We've got to be hearing. So please share it. Even though it might be feel a little bit off key, just share it. We need the whole picture. So have a great week. God bless you all.
The Lord bless you. Face shine upon you, be gracious. precious to you, the Lord, turn here.